I love the 4th of July. The fireworks, the food, friends and family get-togethers. It reminds me of being a kid again. It's a great day to be American. But the other 364 days a year, it's gotten harder for me.
Here briefly is the timeline this evening. All the networks called Florida for Al Gore. Then phones lit up at all the networks. It was senior officials in Austin, Texas, calling the networks saying, look, trust us, something's wrong with your Florida numbers.
And you all called Florida before the polls had even closed, and we feel good about Florida. We have a fabulous organization there.
They're still looking for some ballot boxes that are missing here, but they are out there with deputies looking for the ballot boxes.
This whole issue of calling states on the basis of exit polling is something that needs to be taken another serious look at.
That might explain why those exit polls revealed Gore as the winner, and then the networks had to pull back and say, well, the state is still in play, because it doesn't take into account this. Okay, Kerry, you're still with us. I'm sorry, we're getting some confusing signals in my ear. I'm not sure. Brian, are you with me still?
Yeah, we're all with you.
Brian, are you still with me?
All right, we've lost communications with Kerry Sanders. It happens.
Well, we put Florida back into the too close to call category. You're saying you're going to take Florida?
I mean, yes, we're going to take Florida. Florida.
In 2000, the campaign chair of one of the presidential candidates was also running his election in the decisive state of Florida. Secretary of State Catherine Harris wrongfully removed thousands of African Americans from the voting rolls and repeatedly stopped vote counts.
In denying these requested amendments.
The Republican-led Supreme Court even issued an emergency stay to stop the recounting of votes in Florida.
I hereby declare Governor George W. Bush the winner of Florida's 25 electoral votes for the President of the United States.
Something felt very wrong. But I went back to my life, because after all, I'm just some dude. I've been some dude pretty much all my life. I like cartoons. I like playing with my dog, seeing live music. I'm not registered with either political party. And sometimes, forgetting is the best medicine. But you can only block out reality for so long. In 2004, I couldn't believe I was watching it again. The exit polls reported John Kerry winning the vote in Ohio. Tens of thousands of African Americans didn't get to vote. And again, the Secretary of State running the election was the campaign chair for the winning candidate.
The 2004 election is over and George Bush has been freely and fairly re-elected President of the United States.
And despite all this being apparent, John Kerry hastily conceded the election, giving up any chance at challenging Ken Blackwell's vote totals.
Even when all the provisional ballots are counted, which they will be, there won't be enough outstanding votes for us to be able to win Ohio. And therefore, we cannot win this election. My friends.
And there was that feeling again.
It was here.
But none of my friends thought our elections could be stolen. Not here. We all grew up thinking that kind of tyranny happens in the Third World or the old Soviet bloc. In the Ukrainian elections, vote fraud became apparent. Thousands took to the streets for days to protest the outcome. What first gave away election fraud? The exit polls showed a significant difference from the government-reported vote count. Even the White House agreed.
We strongly support efforts to review the conduct of the election and urge Ukrainian authorities not to certify results until investigations of organized fraud are resolved.
How come they can't do it in Ohio? If they can do it in Ukraine, how come they can't do it in Ohio? If they can do it in Ukraine.
So why couldn't it happen here? When I was a kid in school, I learned the famous story about our founding father, George Washington, and how he was so honest, even as a kid.
I cannot tell a lie. It was I who cut down this cherry tree.
Except, that story's not really true. He didn't wear a wig or wooden teeth either.
So if our ideal of truth is a lie, then what is truth? And why did I still want that myth of honesty to be real?
You okay, Murph? Pull up security.
We stopped Murph bleeding.
He's bleeding.
Murph's bleeding.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. We gotta go.
When it's my countrymen dying for a lie, I'm not having that.
It appears that there were not weapons of mass destruction there.
You said you knew where they were.
I did not. I said I knew where suspect sites were, and we were just...
You said you knew where they were, near Tikrit, near Baghdad, and northeast, south, and west of there. Those are your words.
My words were that...
So, ladies and gentlemen, I present a White House election year album. Those weapons of mass destruction got to be somewhere.
The media seemed willing to laugh off the lies that got us into an illegal war. It seemed like neither politicians nor the press cared about the truth. The next spring, between articles about Britney Spears and American Idol, there it was. The theft of the 2004 election in Ohio, in heavily footnoted detail by Robert F. Kennedy Jr. I started researching on my own, and I discovered one of RFK's sources, Greg Palast, a best-selling author and BBC journalist who hunts down voter suppression like a private eye.
Jeb Bush and Catherine Harris knocked off tens of thousands of voters. They called them criminals when basically they were just guilty of voting while black.
I caught up with Palast in New York while he was running between appearances on Fox News and MSNBC.
What's wrong with Ohio?
What's wrong with Ohio? Okay, the problem is that Bush didn't win it, but he was declared the winner. The fix was in. I was just on Fox TV with some crazy woman. Yeah, George Bush won fair and square by the rules. Well, he didn't win fair or square, but he won by the rules that they ran.
The rules. On the playground, the teacher told us, it's not whether you win or lose, it's how you play the game. But what if the other side isn't playing fair? These elections, after all the time and money and hot air, they're won by just a few votes. It's like in football, when the players all scramble and fight for the ball in a free-for-all. And if one team gets the ball just a few inches closer, they score a touchdown. And if not, the other team gets possession. With so much at stake, people cheat. If they think they can get away with it.
Touchdown!
And just a handful of votes, a couple of inches, decide our future. Until 2004, I didn't even know where Ohio was on the map. But no Republican has ever won the presidency without winning Ohio. And in 2006, I learned that Ohio had a big decision to make about its own future.
To change Ohio, it's time for Ken Blackwell as governor, and he's earned it.
If Ken Blackwell were to govern the swing state of Ohio and institutionalize his brand of elections, it'd be like forging his own key to the White House. I couldn't sit back anymore and be some dude shaking my head. I had to go to Ohio to see where our elections were going wrong and what was really happening at the bottom of this free-for-all.
Now to break the news, now to break the beat, now to break the ice, now to break the beat.
arriving in Ohio, I had a lot of questions and few answers.
We gotta go west. I guess, I don't know, there aren't any signs here.
What really happened in 2004? Were the 2006 elections liable to be derailed the same way? What time zone am I in? Could I speak the language? I needed an important source, like Deep Throat was in Watergate. I didn't have that. But I did find this Ohio tourism video narrated by the guy who played Deep Throat in All the President's Men, Hal Holbrook.
Millions of years ago, ancient seas covered all of Ohio. These seas left behind the mineral deposits of coal and petroleum that would fuel the great industrial revolution of the 19th century. Today, if the state of Ohio were its own separate nation, its economy would be the 17th largest in the world.
Ohio happens to be at the epicenter of American politics. I think it's a great rural, urban, academic, conservative, Cleveland liberals, heartland conservatives, all in the same mix. Procter & Gamble learned to test their products here very well for a reason.
If there's one state that both parties will be focused on, it's Ohio. Public attitudes there often mirror the mood of the entire country.
So does that mean if the elections here are fraudulent, they could be fraudulent across the country? I asked Ohioans if they thought their elections were run well.
I did hear there were issues in Ohio and or questions about the legitimacy of, you know, the voting machines. There's just different things that were going on, scandals and shenanigans, and I believe it.
I still have some burning issues that won't go away, pertaining particularly to 2004's election. Lots and lots of people were disenfranchised.
Old bull. I don't believe that. He said black people lost their vote.
Thousands of people lost their vote.
How do you know?
What was proven on TV?
I don't remember seeing that.
You're kidding me.
No, I don't. Huh?
The lines were extremely long, and it was awful how the people had to stand, older people coming in those scooters, and how they had to wait.
I was only in line, I think, an hour and 10 minutes.
There were some irregularities all throughout Mahoning County. At one time, the count was that they had over 1 million votes that were cast in a county of 270,000. It's obvious that there was a miscalculation. They said it was just a glitch in the computer and that they worked that out.
When an elected leader reports something, it is official. But does that make it true? It seems like politicians strive to say official things without having to commit to a truth.
People have got to know whether or not their president's a crook. Well, I'm not a crook.
We did not repeat. Did not trade weapons or anything else for hostages.
Read my lips.
I did not have sexual relations with that woman.
Americans love the idea of truth, justice, the American way, but we know we're being lied to regularly.
Saddam Hussein aids and protects terrorists, including members of Al-Qaeda.
So, if the official story is untrue, then what is truth? I asked some smart people.
What is truth?
What is truth? Wow.
What is truth? What do you mean by the question?
I failed philosophy in college.
What is truth?
What do you mean?
Is this a theological question, a metaphysical question, a public policy question? What is truth?
I'm one of those, if I can touch it, it's there.
It's heavy question, what is truth?
I can't answer that question. It's a vague, abstract matter. It depends on what the evidence points you to.
There's different ways of looking at truth, isn't there? You know, and of course, lawyers argue that black is white and white is black and there's no such thing as gray.
The truth is, I didn't know the first thing about Ohio politics. The Republican Party declined to talk to me. I thought they'd be more laid back, since their headquarters are on the corner of High and Gay. But since the GOP controls most of the government in Ohio, they have a lot to lose in this election, and little to gain by talking on camera to some dude from LA. Rocky Saxby is a prominent Republican attorney in Ohio. His father was Attorney General under Presidents Nixon and Ford, and he's represented Ken Blackwell. But he was supporting Ted Strickland for governor, so he would talk to me.
The Republican Party in Ohio has a pretty well-oiled political machine, while the Democrats have been sometimes characterized as a fart in a skillet. They're all over the place.
The Democratic Party, on the other hand, seemed to answer the phone on the first ring.
Can you paint a portrait for me of the corruption in Ohio?
Watercolors or acrylics?
Mixed media.
It seemed like the party chairman didn't take me very seriously either. But the upcoming election was serious business.
This is an election that will change our lives. This is the kind of election which will determine the future of the country, because if you elect a Democrat in Ohio in 06, you're going to elect a Democrat for president in 08.
So do you personally feel the weight of the national issues?
I haven't slept in 6 weeks.
Kenneth Blackwell, yeah! Our next governor! Yeah! Hallelujah! It is barbarically filthy governor. For anybody to practice sex in their anal rectal. God bless America!
The Democratic hopeful to beat Ken Blackwell is U.S. Representative Ted Strickland. Moderating this pivotal race is Ken Blackwell?
I don't believe there to be an inherent conflict of interest because of that. Bob Taft, the current governor, was Secretary of State before Ken Blackwell, and Bob Taft oversaw both his re-election to Secretary of State and his election to governor.
But maybe Matt Damschroeder isn't the best judge of conflict of interest. He was penalized a month's pay for accepting a $10,000 check in his office from the voting machine maker Diebold in 2004. He insisted it wasn't a bribe, it was a donation to the Franklin County Republican Party, which Damschroeder also chaired. Dude, that's a conflict of interest.
In theory, I don't see a conflict, but in practice, maybe with Mr. Blackwell there is.
For Ken Blackwell, they're holding him to a different standard, and it just is not fair.
His job to oversee the election, and he has nothing to gain by messing around with that, or he'll never be governor.
I spoke to another Ohio politician who once ran for governor and was no stranger to scandal himself.
I spent time with a woman I shouldn't have, and I paid her with a check. I wish I hadn't done that, and the truth is, I wish no one would ever know.
The check was good. That was always got me, is why did people doubt my credit?
Back in the day, Jerry Springer and Ken Blackwell were friends in Cincinnati government. So I asked him how he felt about Blackwell's candidacy.
The chief election official of the state of Ohio is running for governor, was the campaign chairman for Bush in the presidential race. Am I the only person that sees that maybe that's a little bit unfair?
I posed this question of fairness to the citizens of Ohio at the state's most sacred site, a Buckeyes home game.
Excuse me, I'm interviewing Buckeyes today. Can I ask you a couple questions? Okay, cool, let's go.
Ohioans' love of their number one football team transcends politics, religion, family, and mortality.
What if the game was rigged somehow?
Well, there's nothing really
but it won't
you
be rigged.
Do about it.
Ohio State rocks, they won't do that.
It happens.
Then I hope we win.
As long as it's fixed in your favor, it's that, okay?
That's okay.
That'd be bad?
That'd be bad, yeah.
The game was what?
Rigged.
I would be really upset.
What do you think would happen?
I don't know. Somebody'd probably get in some trouble.
As long as it's in our favor, who cares?
If Ohio State loses today, there will be a riot.
We'd have a rough night, I'm sure.
What if the opposing coach was the referee? Get out of here, man. I just said, get out of here.
They can't do that, can they? I don't think that's possible.
Obviously, it wouldn't be fair, but that would never happen in society. Yeah. I mean, that's like something in a movie script.
Woo!
Why wouldn't that ever happen in modern society? Some people thought because each county makes its own rules, it's harder to influence this patchwork of random elections.
We have 88 counties in this state. Each county has a bipartisan board of elections.
You would have to have an awful lot of collusion among each of these different boards of elections, and collusion from both Democrats and Republicans working together in every one of Ohio's 88 counties.
The Ohio election boards are really, they're bipartisan, two and two. So if they have a tie, J. Kenneth Blackwell breaks every vote. So you keep hearing how they're bipartisan, but they're designed to stall on every vote, hence giving every decision to the Secretary of State. So it all depends on how partisan the Secretary of State is.
All right, so how partisan is Ken Blackwell as Secretary of State? In reviewing the problem surrounding the 2004 election in Ohio, a federal commission issued the Conyers report that stated, "We find that there were massive and unprecedented voter irregularities and anomalies in Ohio. These irregularities were caused by intentional misconduct and illegal behavior, much of it involving Secretary of State J. Kenneth Blackwell." It seemed like the more I looked, the worse Blackwell got.
In 2004, Blackwell came out with a directive. You must vote in the precinct in which you now live. And if you don't vote there, your vote must not be counted.
And then what they did is they systematically switched all the precincts, shuffled them at the last second. So, and then Blackwell admits he didn't have enough time, hence the information on his website was 6 months old.
And some of those people even got to the right room, but it was a gymnasium and there were three or four polling precincts in the same room and they ended up at the wrong table. And because of Blackwell's directive, they lost the right to have their vote count.
Another suspicious move by Blackwell was that he prevented any oversight for the 2004 election.
International observers actually came into Ohio and J. Kenneth Blackwell, in a very famous article that was in Cincinnati Inquirer, threatened to arrest them if they got within 100 feet of the polls.
Doesn't all of this make you wonder just what the hell Ken Blackwell is up to?
And anytime you call him into question for his conduct, then he gets very jittery about it and starts screaming and hollering and the like.
After the 2004 election, Stephanie Tubbs Jones tried to question Blackwell about the job he did.
Secretary Blackwell, it's so kind of you to come before our committee this afternoon and answer questions.
Good to see you.
It was so good to see me that you chose not to shake my hand in the ante room. Is that correct, sir?
I chose not to shake your hand.
No, that's the question is, you chose not to shake my hand in the ante room because it was so good to see me. Was that correct?
I chose not to shake your hand, so I see how you comport yourself in this setting.
Well, you know what? Watch me, sir.
But who in Ohio's one-party rule will challenge Blackwell? The Republican governor convicted of ethics charges? The Republican attorney general? The Republican state auditor? The Republican Supreme Court? The Republican state legislature?
Every suggestion indicates that Kim Blackwell is about to pull the same tricks he pulled in 2004.
Could Blackwell twist this election in 2006 like he did in 2004 so that he'd be able to control the ultimate swing state in 2008? When someone so partisan and arrogant is running this election, how could you trust that anything would be fair? What is truth?
Truth is all that we expect someone to say, to tell us what's right and not what's wrong, not to misrepresent.
We're going to have an election in November where the count is accurate, the machines are reliable, and the election is fair.
One of the biggest decisions a Secretary of State can make is about getting the top-of-the-line voting machines of tomorrow.
On machines, every vote that's cast is counted. The count is mechanically accurate.
There have been countless studies, reports, and complaints about the unreliability, inaccuracy, and insecurity of electronic voting machines.
And these machines are very hackable, so if a machine is unsupervised for more than a minute, someone could get to it and put in a virus or a hack.
This is crazy.
You are able to hack into it in 10 seconds.
It takes only a few seconds to insert a computer virus into this voting machine.
When these votes go into an electronic device, we can't see them being counted, and that's a problem.
Voting came to a standstill when people had trouble using the machines.
Fraud or intent for fraud aside, these systems just don't seem to work well.
I vote for Kerry, and what came up was Bush.
We've had some testimony here in Cuyahoga County about vote flipping, where you vote for one candidate and it registers for another.
It wasn't hard for me to find people who saw electronic voting machines change their votes right before their eyes.
It was one of the first times you got to press the electronic voting computer machine. When I pressed John Kerry, It went right over to Bush.
And so I went back and looked at all the issues. Everything was fine, with the exception of one issue. For the choice of president, it no longer said John Kerry. It had now reverted to a no vote status. And this is exactly what they were talking about in the media.
There's so much controversy and mistrust of Diebold that once I came across their headquarters in the middle of nowhere outside of Canton, Ohio, I was actually scared. I mean, their name is Diebold. The shiny fortress looked like the Death Star. And when I drove around and peered into their complex, I saw Diebold's motto, "We won't rest." How scary is that? But I was determined to go inside and demand the truth.
Since this company does so much with our voting machines, I just wanted to find out some basic information about it.
Let's turn these off, please.
I just wanted some basic information.
I can't provide that.
Are you the manager?
No, I'm not. We have nothing we can do for you guys.
Okay. Yeah. Can you just answer just a basic question for me?
Possibly. What?
How do you pronounce it? Is it Diebold or Diebold?
Diebold.
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 Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
All right.
Thanks. Have a good day.
You too.
Well, that settles that.
Well, maybe I wasn't able to get much from Diebold, so I met with the director of the Miami County Board of Elections to see one of these machines for myself.
I kind of like the paper ballot because you have a paper trail. This is an add-on after the fact, after the design. This is the verified voter paper audit trail. What I dislike about this is it's subject to jamming. They may not fully snap that down.
Right.
So they have printer interface errors. You can only have between 125 and 165 ballots on the paper trail. You pull it out and then you start physically counting.
They seem like cheap pieces of crap.
Open this up, roll it up. So it's kind of a bulky mechanism.
How did these unsophisticated voting machines end up all over Ohio for the 2004 elections? And why are they still being used here in 2006?
It's an organization that operates very close to the vest. It's a big company in Ohio, and they know what they, and they protect their interests.
In August 2003, Diebold CEO Wally Odell attended a strategy meeting at President Bush's ranch in Crawford, Texas. I would have attended, but my schedule was packed. A week later, Wally invited 100 people to his mansion in Upper Arlington, Ohio for a $1,000 a plate fundraiser, writing that he was committed to helping Ohio deliver its electoral votes to the president next year. The next day, Republican Secretary of State Ken Blackwell authorized Diebold to be one of three electronic voting machines in Ohio's 2004 election in a contract worth $100 million. He was promptly sued by another manufacturer for unfairly favoring Diebold in the bidding process. Ken Blackwell's financial disclosure forms later revealed that he owned 178 shares of stock in Diebold.
This is a conflict of interest. In most states, if you're holding somebody's stock and you negotiate a unbid contract with them, you go to jail. In Ohio, you apparently get to run for governor.
But besides voting machines, Diebold also makes machines that count paper ballots, tabulate votes, and more.
And there's all of these other voting machine companies in America, ES&S, Sequoia, Hart InterCivic, who are no better and who are, in many cases, even worse companies.
Something I was realizing was that Ohio and many other states have been increasingly farming out the jobs of our elections to private corporations.
We have a new gimmick in America. It used to be that we, the people, would handle our own elections. We would elect the government, which would then handle elections. Now we've privatized it. We've put it out to bid, just like the contracts in Iraq, okay? And like the contracts in Iraq, where the money goes missing, here the votes seem to go missing.
You're not supposed to see this. This is a proprietary printout sheet
of a private company that's tallying the votes. And as we send out to private companies the tally for the vote, all the precincts go in, and a private company adds it all up. And we hope that our votes influence their decision. Okay, this is precinct 9D in a county in New Mexico. And there's the Bush-Cheney total. There's the Cobb total. I don't know who Perutka is. Darnick and Nader. Where's John?
Oh, John Kerry.
There's no John. Yeah, remember he ran for president. He's not listed, okay? He's been electronically zapped. Not there. So you don't know that. The totals come out, and you don't get this sheet.
And where did you get it then?
Well, that's called investigative reporting. People slip it out the back doors to me. Unfortunately, then people say I'm courageous. That's not true. It's the people that turn this stuff over to me that are courageous.
This privatization and corporatization of secret software that nobody can ever see how they work. Even the people who use the systems, the election officials, they don't have a clue.
Voting is not a commercial enterprise. It's not supposed to be a for-profit operation. You can fire your elected officials. You can look at their processes using the Freedom of Information Act. You can't file a Freedom of Information Act on the private contractors. These guys know it.
It's completely 100% faith-based voting. And it's, you know, like waiting every 4 years for the magical election fairy to come down and tell us who won. And we're all supposed to go, oh, okay.
And in Ohio, Ken Blackwell's privatization of elections was state of the art. Blackwell outsourced his 2004 election results webpage to be designed and maintained by GovTech, a company run by Mike Connell, who has worked for the Bush family since the 80s. His other firm, New Media, serves a who's who of Republicans.
Bush-Cheney 2000, Bush-Cheney 2004, Ohio Republican Party, Ohioans for Blackwell, Republican National Committee.
A side project of Mike Connell's was the website Swift Boat Veterans for Truth. But the fact that the world got the Ohio election results from a website made by the same web designer smearing Bush's opponent wasn't the only suspect thing on election night.
The web servers for the election results in Ohio were suddenly moved in the middle of the night, I think around 1 a.m. or so, it moved from Ohio to Tennessee. The entire business of reporting these numbers on the web, where media and the rest of America actually take them from, was being run by this far-right partisan web server company.
Some of the other websites that SmartTech was hosting were
georgewbush.com, rnc.org, gop.com, ohiogop.com, newt.org, gingrichproductions.com, amendforarnold.org.
We shouldn't be surprised because you had such a far right-wing Secretary of State, J. Kenneth Blackwell, in Ohio. So it was a little surprise that that's the sort of company that he would work with to oversee in a fair and impartial manner the presidential election in Ohio in 2004.
The election results might as well have been emailed to the Republican Party before being officially reported. And in the upcoming 2006 election, Ken Blackwell would be sending the results out of state to the same smart tech servers again. So, in 2004, Ken Blackwell, the man running the presidential election in Ohio, while co-chair of George Bush's campaign, certifies dubious voting machines from a guy who really wants Bush to win, sends the results out of state to the Bush campaign's servers, then reports the results through a website designed by a guy who's already making websites lying about Bush's opponent, with the only difference in 2006 being that it's now Ken Blackwell's own election. Does all of this give you confidence that the vote totals will totally not be tampered with? I don't know. I'm just some dude. I wasn't even in Ohio in 2004. Even if I was, I couldn't have been in all 88 counties at the same time. But neither were you. What is truth?
Truth can only be something that is verifiable by 1,000 different people looking at the same information. That is truth.
It's the reality most supported by the consensus of the people, I guess, to some extent.
The ultimate repository of the truth in a democracy is this election process. It's not just one individual dreaming it up.
I believe in fair elections because
I believe in my fellow American. And that if people's voices are heard over a broad spectrum, the truth will get out. Right?
I went back to my college to learn how deep this corruption goes from Professor Mark Crispin Miller, a foremost authority on election problems.
The same people who were in charge of subverting the original count were also there to subvert the subsequent efforts, right? The audit system can be gamed and so on, and recounts can be undercut.
I feel that the 2004 general election was stolen before my eyes, and I didn't realize it. The irregularities that I did observe was a representative from the Triad Company coming into our office without an invitation from us, and they came in free to remove candidates that were not going to be recounted and tore apart our computers and moved hard drives with the ballots on those. Parts were all over the place, on the floor of both computers. So he got everything back together and he said, it's working fine now. Do not turn that computer off, the one that's connected to the tabulator. Don't turn it off. Leave it on until the recount.
The Board of Elections people do the best job that they can, and they do a very thorough job. The more information you give someone, the better job they can do.
As Michael was preparing to leave, Lisa Schwartz, director, said to him, I'm really worried about, you know, the recount. she even said something, what can we do to make sure everything comes out right? Is it set? Is everything right? And he said, yes. He said, it's okay, but if you want to make sure that it's going to come out right to the public, you could put a piece of paper on the wall, for instance, that only the board and the two of you would know the meaning of the piece of paper, which would be like a code.
You were just trying to help them so that they wouldn't have to do a full recount of the county.
Right.
As much information as possible is what I was trying to provide them with.
All he did was work on that tabulator and the computers and inform us how to use a cheat sheet. And then he left. And they went to 44 counties and did the same thing.
Did any of your counties have to do the full recount that you're aware of?
Not that I'm aware of.
I feel sick about it. I believed in the voting process. I was a part of it. All I wanted was an investigation to see if anything improper was done. But it was never done. We had some sort of a kangaroo court in there for Michael Barbian that was one-sided. He was cleared of everything.
Cheryl Eaton was fired by Ken Blackwell because she wasn't a team player, they said to her. And, you know, her response was, well, why should I be a team player when the team is corrupt, right? She got very ill afterwards. It was kind of a horrible situation. That's just, you know, one symptom of a much deeper and more pervasive corruption.
How did these electronic voting machines take over our country? In the wake of problems in the Florida 2000 election, Congress passed the Help America Vote Act, HAVA, in 2002.
Terrible piece of legislation that has encouraged the states and counties all over the country to go to these god-awful, untested electronic voting machines.
HAVA required spending $3 billion of taxpayer money on new voting machines across the country. Touchscreen voting machines.
Why voting machines? Well, money.
The congressman who drafted HAVA was Representative Bob Ney of Ohio. Bob Ney's other successful legislation was to rename the Capitol Hill cafeteria's French fries as Freedom Fries, to shame France for not supporting the invasion of Iraq.
We have nothing against French people, the French language. However, we're angry at the French government. And today, you can have your toast, just make sure it's Freedom Toast.
Diebold paid Bob Ney's former chief of staff, David DiStefano, $180,000 and Jack Abramoff $275,000 to convince Bob Nade to include their machines as part of HAVA. Jack Abramoff was later convicted of bribing Bob Nade. And now, in the 2006 race, Bob Nade pled guilty to corruption charges in the Abramoff scandal. He drops his bid for re-election and checks into rehab. One of Nade's aides reported that he would start drinking at 7:30 in the morning. That means the laws we now have that govern our national elections were written by a criminal while drunk, as in, HAVA, another drink. Bob Nade's HAVA did offer one improvement for disenfranchised voters, the provisional ballot. This way, if there was a problem with your registration at the polls, you could still cast a vote that could be counted later on. The need for this kind of backup ballot also came from the Florida fiasco in 2000. Jeb Bush and Katherine Harris wrongfully purged over 100,000 voters from the voting rolls, most of them African Americans who didn't know they couldn't vote until Election Day.
This is the program. This I got from Katherine Harris's office. The excuse is these are people who are felons, criminals. They're not allowed to vote under law in the state of Florida. They've been convicted of crime.
Voters were removed by ChoicePoint database technologies if their names were even similar to a felon in another state.
The entire list of 57,000, there was not one illegal voter, not one. The first thing that caught my eye was people like Bernice Kynes, who is convicted of a crime in January of 2009. Well, hello, we were finding this in 2000. Okay, so she's a criminal. Bernice is a criminal of the future. And there are 500 criminals of the future. 92% of the people on the so-called felon list were never convicted of any crime. Were not felons. Their only crime was voting while black. Because of the phony purge of felons in 2000, Congressional Black Caucus won the right to have every citizen get a ballot, a provisional ballot, if their name's not on the voter rolls. That was in the Help America Vote Act. The problem was, you got the right to get a ballot. You never got the right to have that ballot counted. 3 million people were handed provisional ballots. That means 3 million people were not given real ballots in 2004. 1,090,000 provisional ballots were not counted very selectively. The big non-count in places like Ohio, in New Mexico, in Florida, in those swing states that somehow ended up in the Bush pile.
The places where the provisional ballots are mostly are the obvious places, wherever you find a lot of black and poor people. They're in the large urban cities. Where you won't find them is in affluent white Republican suburbs.
Seems like provisional ballots are just a newer way to not count your vote, especially if you're black.
Why are black people mainly targeted to get their votes knocked out?
Well, it's not the color of their skin, it's the color of their vote. They vote blue. We saw in Ohio in 2004 where voting machines were actually removed from precincts, so you had long lines. It was not because of a surprise turnout. For a hotly contested presidential election, they knew.
Voter registration up 27%. Machines, too, are gone.
It was deliberate, and it was effective.
To say that Democrat or African-American precincts suffered in a disproportionate fashion as compared to Republican or white precincts just isn't true.
I was in 8 wards in Franklin County, and they were overwhelmingly African-American. What I found was the voting machines were missing, is that the Franklin County Board of Election had forgotten to put out machines. And I also found lines between 4 and 7 hours long. And I found about 20% of the people in line were walking away.
The reality was we just didn't have enough voting machines. For every precinct that someone can point to me saying this is a Democrat precinct that didn't have enough voting machines, we can point to Republican precincts that didn't have enough voting machines. The reality is people all across the county had to wait in line and vote. And the good news is, there were more people that did vote that didn't.
When Ken Blackwell was questioned about why he didn't order enough voting machines, he didn't take too kindly to it.
In your brilliance, will you tell me who would have paid for it?
I'm sorry?
In your brilliance, would you tell me who would have paid for it?
It's a possibility you would not have had that, even though you got the third highest amount of money from HAVA.
Can you tell me who would have paid for it?
But you know what, Mr. Secretary of State? You are the chief election officer.
That ain't going straight,
and
I am.
You
and tell you something.
Should have had...
I am not the legislature. I am the Secretary of State.
You have to understand this is a concerted campaign not to count people's votes, to stop people from voting, to prevent them from voting. I mean, you have to understand what the Republicans did. I had, for BBC, we discovered something called caging lists.
Pull up the caging lists. Past midnight in October of 2004, just before the elections, the chairman of the Republican Party of Florida and the head of research and communications out of the RNC, you're talking top bananas here. And they're communicating about something called caging list. Here's a caging list, here's a caging list, here's another caging list, here's a caging list. What the heck is a caging list? I don't know what a caging list is. And the team set to work and looked up where all these people are located and who they were, and they're all in black precincts except these guys. And who are these guys? It says Naval Air Station. The Republican Party, as it turned out, was sending first-class letters to black soldiers with Do Not Fort. When the letter arrives, it says it's sent back as undeliverable. And the Republicans use that as the excuse to say this is a suspect voter. And what makes that particularly interesting is that's against the law. Mass challenges of voters where race is a factor is a violation of federal law. It's a violation of the Voting Rights Act.
And the Republican Party at first said, hey, these are our donors. And it includes sheets of people from, the Jacksonville rescue mission for the homeless.
Caging tactics are how do you keep the black vote, which you know is a Democratic vote, in a cage? How do you make sure they don't vote? You mess with their registration, post stuff saying, Republicans vote on Tuesday, Democrats on Wednesday.
These deceptive flyers were distributed around African American neighborhoods, telling people to show up to vote the day after the election.
We tend sometimes to focus a little too much on voting machines, as if the problem lies there exclusively. The party wants, ideally, to prevent as many people as voting before the fact. That saves them the trouble of having to, erase or annihilate or alter votes later on. They were called the Texas Strike Force. The people who were bussed into Ohio by the party and put up on the party's tab, put in hotels, and given these lists of names and so on, and given phone banks, etc., calling up voters the night before the election.
This is the Board of Elections. I see here on the computer you got some unpaid parking tickets.
Don't show up to vote tomorrow.
You will be arrested, sent to jail.
I mean, I don't mean to alarm you.
Go down there with that unpaid child support. Probably going to walk out in bracelets.
Employees of the hotel where they were staying overheard them making these calls and actually alerted the authorities to it because it was clearly an effort to intimidate people out of voting.
As we look at the history of African Americans, fear and violence were the biggest problems around voting. We're not talking about dogs and hoses, but mm-hmm. We're talking about confusion and misinformation. And that's the new tactic.
Following in the footsteps of HAVA, the Ohio Congress passed more new voting laws in House Bill 3, making fair elections even harder.
I always try to protect my wallet as soon as I hear someone say election reform. It's always been used to steal your vote.
We have a litany of ID requirements that you may now use to identify yourself at the polling locations. Unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, they're just not necessary because the problem doesn't exist. In conference, I described it as using a sledgehammer or a cannon to swat a fly. And that's, in fact, what these ID requirements are.
House Bill 3 said that the reason for authoring the bill was to root out fraud in the state of Ohio. There has only been four cases of fraud in the state of Ohio in the past 8 years.
It led some cynics to suggest that it was no longer an election reform bill, but in fact the Republican Party Preservation Act of 2006.
Republicans have figured out that the fewer people that actually vote, that actually get to cast a vote, the better their chances are of winning. So they have put forward this scheme, and it's been a well-funded, well-organized scheme to get this notion out there that there's this massive Democratic voter fraud going on. Photo ID restrictions at the polling place will most definitely disenfranchise anywhere from 20 to 30 million in this country who don't have a state-issued driver's license, for example. Why don't they have it? Well, because they're elderly. They no longer drive. Or they're city dwellers. They're urban folks who don't even have a car. This is a scam. It's not about voter fraud for these people. It's about voter suppression, period.
There's going to be a lot of confusion because people don't know what type of identification to bring.
The big, beautiful ID flyer.
And frankly, I really don't like the We ID part of that.
How on earth are the poll workers going to figure this out?
You can get in and out of the United States of America with a passport, but you cannot use a passport to vote in the state of Ohio.
They've got no idea what's going on. They don't know what HB3 did, mostly because, as they said to us, the Secretary of State's giving them no guidance on this.
Some of the things that we're learning as we go and visit these boards of elections, if they're confused, voters are going to be confused, so we need to begin to talk about strategy as well.
You need to do massive amounts of voter education.
We've got to reinforce it.
Right. We've been doing that, but it doesn't seem to get traction with the press. How are we going to frame it different?
I go back to Britney Spears. I know. Like, we all know about Britney Spears. We know she's pregnant. We know she's in a bad marriage. We know all this stuff, and why do we know it? It's not because we want to know it, right? We know all of this because it's omnipresent. Even CNN covers this kind of crazy. Yes. So what we really need to do is have the kind of campaign where it's as available and immediate, and people are really aware that they need to bring their ID.
That's a dumb question.
No question is dumb.
Yeah, dumb question. Suppose everything goes well when you get elected.
That's a dumb question.
That is a dumb question.
I just tried it. Nobody believes that, right?
No. The outcome of these rules is clearly voter suppression. Whether or not someone sat at a table and said, this is how we're gonna impact them, I don't know, I wasn't there.
Truth is running fair elections. Truth is finding out who best represents your interest, who best represents the community that you're a part of.
The fact was is that we had a great election in 2004. We had a bipartisan system. African Americans turned out in a record number.
Am I the only one struck that a black guy named Blackwell seems to be doing everything imaginable to make the voting rights of blacks not well?
Blackwell saw that Catherine Harris, as he said himself, that Catherine Harris didn't end up on a soup line, but ended up in Congress.
In India, there was Mother Teresa, and in Florida, there was Catherine Harris!
The next governor of the state of Ohio, John Kenneth Blackwell.
Ken's actually one of my oldest political friends because we were classmates at Xavier from 1966 through 1970. I was student body president at Xavier in our senior year. Ken was president of the Black Student Association on campus. Ken, as I recall, was involved in supporting voting rights, voter registration programs while he was a student on campus. Ken later was very involved in a whole series of voter registration programs, both while he was on campus and particularly off campus, as a lot of us who were involved in politics were. He even talked the Xavier administration into sending Ken and a couple of other of the members of the Black Student Association to Martin Luther King's funeral. And it doesn't surprise me today to look at him and see him in important political leadership positions. What continuously shocks the hell out of me is to see where his political philosophy has gone from, frankly, being pretty far on the left as a college student and social activist to now having gone very, very far to the right.
When Reagan became popular, he decided to become a
a Republican. So he's gone through the transition of each, you know, and then once he became a Republican, he became a very conservative Republican and went to the base.
Man of the hour for this area, and I'm talking about Ken Blackwell, who we need desperately in the United States Congress.
There is absolutely more opportunity for an African-American statewide in the Republican Party than there has been for African-American Democrats.
I think that Ken goes whichever way the grass is greener. If he sticks up his finger and the wind blows, that's where he is.
What pisses you off most?
Ken Blackwell, his version of the truth. You asked me what the truth was. I'm not sure Ken Blackwell has a definition of truth because his changes from day to day.
I think truth is found in some moral absolutes. I think that light conquers dark.
I'm the granddaughter of a slave. He would get up and give us a bit of a sermon. He would say, get an education. Have your own bank account. And then third, he said, vote. The store, the house that he built was a store on the first level. It was turned over for voting every year. And I can remember looking through the cracks and seeing the people go into the little booths and pull the curtain behind them and saying, that I will do one day. And I have. I've never missed voting since I was 21.
We fought so hard for all Americans to vote. And now it seems like we're fighting all over again.
You called the state before the polls had closed in a considerable part of the state, and the results are becoming clear tonight. That part of the state is, the panhandle is voting overwhelmingly for Governor Bush.
When it comes from people like Karl Rove, Ken Blackwell, people in positions of authority who are, of course, very close to one of the campaigns, the media listens to what these guys have to say when any sensible person would take those claims with a big, big bag of salt.
Numbers that don't make sense. And yet, when the media goes to the election officials or somebody like Karl Rove, who has a meme that he wants to get out, for example, oh no, Bush didn't lose in Florida, he won. Just wait for the numbers. It is the old Jedi mind trick. It is, you know, these are not the droids you're looking for. And the media goes out and says, oh, these are not the results we're looking for. In fact, George Bush won in Florida.
Rove is a specialist using, you know, the Jedi mind trick of making you think a new reality, which doesn't exist. All you want to use to determine how people voted are the exit polls. It's the only thing that's reliable.
The exit polls are notoriously accurate because they're asking someone as they walk out of the polls, hey, how did you just vote? It's not like a phone poll.
In 2004, of course, the exit polls in, you know, what, 11 states all spelled victory for John Kerry.
Analysts may put a bit less stock in the inside track data from exit polls. That's because some of the early numbers that got into circulation yesterday turned out to be misleading.
Yesterday, a few of those early numbers leaked to some bloggers, and today there are a few red faces in cyberspace where some of the information was published. The internet published numbers showing a close race, but one that Kerry was on the way to winning. According to one post, Kerry would win not just Ohio, but Florida as well.
So what conclusion did the media draw from this? Well, the conclusion that they drew with the help of mind tricksters in the Republican Party was that the exit polls were wrong. You can't trust exit polls. This is a new one, you know, because anyone who knows anything about polling knows that by and large, exit polls tend to be the most accurate there are.
One of the reasons they offered at the time was that they spoke with too many Kerry voters. Which it was an explanation that sort of defied reason. Perhaps they spoke to too many Kerry voters because more people voted for John Kerry.
This has happened time and time and time again. You got your ear to the ground. You're reading the blogs, you're talking to the people in voter protection groups, you're hearing from voters at different polling places, and they're all telling the same story. I know all these people, they couldn't get into the polling place. They closed the polling place early. The machines weren't working. There weren't enough machines. I was told I couldn't register. I mean, thousands of these reports nationwide. You turn on MSNBC, and it's a completely different story. They say everything went fine today. Very few reports of glitches. I mean, this is something right out of George Orwell's world, you know, or the Soviet Union. There's this radical difference between what real people are telling you and what the media is telling you.
The stuff I can prove with witnesses, with physical evidence that I can corroborate by events and that I can get on my camera.
I don't think humans possess truth, but they possess something almost as good, facts. And that the problem isn't getting the truth. The problem is facing facts.
Truth is based on facts.
The fact is, if you want to stop voter suppression, you have to do it yourself. Like this attorney I met in Cleveland, Subodh Chandra. He took Blackwell to court to loosen the voter ID requirements from House Bill 3. And he won.
None of us want to be back in court again on any of this stuff. I talked to several reporters yesterday who were just like, well, this is the rule, that is the rule. I just talked to the Secretary of State. And I'm like, you know, what the hell are you talking about? That's not what the order says.
Everybody can vote who is properly registered, including people who don't have the forms of ID but do have a Social Security number.
When Subodh Chandra successfully sued Ken Blackwell's office to let people vote without photo IDs, the press managed to report the exact opposite of the decision.
It's absolutely maddening. I mean, we entered into a consent order two nights ago, and it appears that, whether intentionally or incompetently, they are spreading disinformation. So now we have to get on that and contact the media again, say you're getting this wrong. Some media took us up on it, some didn't. Some went off on their own frolic and started misreporting.
What was their source? Ken Blackwell's office. If you win a legal victory against Ken Blackwell to help everybody vote, and then the paper reports it like Ken Blackwell won, what have you accomplished? Vladimir Lenin once said, "A lie repeated often enough becomes true." I'm pretty sure it was Lenin. That's what I always heard.
All right, a little earlier in the show, we talked about voter fraud.
Voter fraud allegations.
Voter fraud investigations.
If there's voter fraud in that state, that could throw the whole presidential election into chaos.
It's already been proven.
Why aren't people going to jail, John?
A few have, but we don't treat voter fraud nearly as seriously as we should.
This voter fraud thing is the boogeyman. It was designed to scare up, to rile the base up. I looked into it. I set up a task force. I couldn't prove the cases, right? Because my job was to do law enforcement, not engage in partisan politics.
The perpetrators become the prosecutors. This is very dangerous stuff. You got the mob in charge of the police department. The Justice Department are the voting rights cops in America. 3 million voters were challenged and shunted to provisional ballots, and 1 million of those ballots were thrown out. So you got 1 million people who lost their vote because they're supposedly illegal voters. And if you bust 25 of them, now you justify challenging 3 million of them. So they leaned on guys like David Iglesias. He's a good Republican. He was appointed by Bush. He chased all over the mesas of New Mexico with the FBI. He found exactly zero fraudulent voters. Alberto Gonzalez, his attorney general, says Iglesias, he's on the list of those to lose their head. Several U.S. attorneys said, not me. That was a line they wouldn't cross, and they got fired. But there's a lot more than 8 prosecutors. How many grabbed their ankles and did the deed? And it was not only who they removed, it was who they put in. In the case of Arkansas, Bud Cummins refused to arrest innocent voters, so they canned his ass. Who did they replace him with? A guy named Tim Griffin. Who is Tim Griffin? Tim Griffin was Karl Rove's assistant. And Tim Griffin, if you look at the emails we discovered from inside the Republican Party computers, Tim Griffin was the guy who was in charge of eliminating the votes of legal voters.
I didn't cage votes, I didn't cage mail, I didn't cage animals, I'm not a zookeeper.
This huge, massive, multi-million-dollar, multi-state operation to knock off hundreds of thousands of voters, his name is on it. He doesn't know what it was.
Caging, as you may know, I had to look it up, is direct mail time for basically organizing returned mail.
It is a term used in direct mail. And before he was counselor, advisor to George Bush, Karl Rove was an expert in direct mail. He was an expert in caging.
First of all, voter registration is probably the most important function that we are undertaking now.
Computers and direct mail are used to pinpoint known Republican and independent voters in every state.
So that same Karl Rove that learned how to get out the vote as a kid is now using the same tools to knock out the vote today?
The game now is not to win the most votes. The game now is to stop the most voters. But the election's been stolen. What you have to do is swipe it back.
Okay. So, now that I'm closer to the truth, I have no idea what to do with it. These other lawyer dudes, they're having a hard time with it. They know way more than me. Why do any of us need to do any of this?
What kind of oversight can citizens and the media have to keep elections fair and just?
You're doing it. I mean, it's fascinating that you're making this film because it ain't being made by Fox News or NBC or ABC or the Petroleum Broadcast System. It's being done independently. All we have is independent media as our protector.
I'm the oversight. That's really depressing. How am I supposed to get it all right? What is truth?
Truth is probably more than any one of us can grasp, but it's something that we all need to continue to strive for.
We can never know truth until maybe a second before you die, God flashes you and wow, there it is. But life is a struggle to figure it out.
So let me get this straight. If the biased officials don't block your registration, they can purge you from the voting rolls or intimidate you. Or send you to the wrong location, or then make you wait in line, and then ask for your ID, but then confuse you with guidelines because of some stupid laws that give you a provisional ballot that won't count because of the untrained poll worker, or, if you're lucky, you may then get to vote on an electronic voting machine. And then what if your candidate just concedes before all of this suppression comes out? What's the point? I came here to help keep these elections honest, but I only see more and more ways that it's completely out of my hands.
This is an old playbook, John, an old playbook. These people didn't invent it, but they have no qualms about using it. I've never seen any evidence that they have any scruples or would honor the rules. It seems to me that they're capable of anything.
I'm sick of feeling helpless and numbing myself to deal with it. I can hang around my hotel room drinking cheap wine and watching bad cable. Or I can do something. We have to take our elections back. But I'm still just one dude, and there's 88 counties. And we've got serious problems. I can't be the oversight for 88 counties at once. But wait. What if there were a bunch of dudes like me out there? I know they're all over Ohio. I've seen them all along the campaign trail. Together, we might stand a chance. But I had to find dudes like me fast. There's only 6 weeks until the election. And then I got lucky at a Jesse Jackson event about protecting the vote in Ohio. A powerful documentary screen there, American Blackout. It showed ways that African Americans had been deliberately disenfranchised in the 2000 and 2004 elections. The director was there. Ian Inaba. I was a huge fan of Ian's music video for Eminem, Mosh, which came out right before the 2004 election as a call to arms. I got up the nerve, I introduced myself, and I told him what I wanted to do for the 2006 elections.
My partner James Rucker and I had gone to Ohio to recruit people for an initiative where citizens would come out with their video cameras and volunteer to kind of monitor the polls real time. So it was a Jesse Jackson rally. And we had, you know, bumped into this guy named John Ennis, who was actually already in the state organizing his own crew of filmmakers. And so we kind of joined forces at that point and decided to just, you know, put everybody under one big banner, which was Video the Vote.
In a time of fed-up voters and the dawn of YouTube, this was an idea whose time had come. I cut together a promo video with Ian's footage from American Blackout. A week before the election, I uploaded it to YouTube.
If the vote is off in Palm Beach County, what about the vote in Iowa? What about the vote in Mississippi? What about the vote in Alabama?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Break down, baby.
Try to turn people away, and it's not right. We need to stop all of this.
But this election, my name is not on the list, and I had to vote a provisional ballot.
The next day, I started getting all these emails. Every minute. YouTube had featured our Video the Vote promo on their homepage. In a day, we had over 100,000 views.
Volunteers started pouring in from the response on YouTube. Then the mainstream media picked up.
But these aren't your traditional poll monitors. Let's go to CNN's Thelma Gutierrez. She's joining us from Los Angeles.
VideoTheVote.org is asking anyone with a video camera to sign up.
Uploading to Video the Vote's link on the website YouTube.
An organization called Video the Vote is stepping up to give frustrated poll workers and voters a voice.
On their website YouTube, you'll see right on the main page a video that comes across as a call to
arms. Now the founders of a new project called Video the Vote say they're going to fight voting irregularities with cameras.
VideoTheVote.org. There's the new edge in citizen journalism.
Video the Vote is really going to be the eyes and ears of America on election day.
I had just hoped for a few dudes in Ohio to help, but in a week, we had over 1,200 volunteers nationwide. They needed to be organized somehow. I had hoped that other video geeks like me would see this and respond. But instead, we were getting tons of people who wanted to help, but they didn't have a video camera, or they didn't know how to edit, or they didn't have a computer, or a car, or high-speed internet, but they still wanted to help somehow. We had to figure out how they could help. So my new friend Melissa from League of Young Voters set up clinics around Ohio for me to help other volunteers. We worked out a system in different cities to best be able to report on election problems and get them uploaded the quickest. I helped organize different teams of shooters and uploaders with dispatchers who were standing by the Election Protection Call Center.
We will be exporting it from when we capture it at high resolution. It'll go on our server. Our server will then export it to YouTube.
I helped people figure out their cameras and ways to label and ID their tapes, the best ways to capture and compress their video, name it, and post it. I focused on helping people set up in the three C's, Columbus, Cincinnati, and Cleveland. I didn't know if any volunteers would show up on election day, or if we'd tape anything helpful.
All of the pundits, all of the left-wing, you know, activists had Ohio in Kerry's column, where the president was down by 9 or 11 points in many of the polls. On election day, you delivered.
I got up at 5:30 in the morning to set up with election protection in Columbus.
Oh, yeah, here it is, Love of Life Fellowship. Oh, I got an email from Ken Blackwell this morning.
And when you vote today, make sure to bring a valid ID.
Even if it shows a previous address, and there's already people being turned away in Columbus for not having the current address.
There's some people starting to post videos to our account, like wrong precincts or people trying to repair signs. I think they're out of Ohio. But I just wanted to see if someone was reviewing them and approving them. Yeah, that's all.
And they told me that since my address is different than what they had listed, and that's what I have on my ID. So I came in and did a provisional ballot. I didn't want to cause a scene. I just didn't want to make any trouble.
So there's footage of poll workers saying that they never got the training about how to handle the ballots or IDs?
He had his driver's license, and he was on the rolls, but he didn't have his current address on the driver's license. So they said, well, you're going to have to vote provisionally. you can provide the last four digits of your social security number, you should be able to vote regular ballot. An older poll worker said, oh no, that's not right, he has to vote provisional.
The County Board of Elections sent out this advisory to all poll workers that they need to let people vote by regular ballot, even if the address. No, they sent it out like this afternoon.
Just four machines there. One of them is broken. We've got this line over here. There are four machines, and only two of them are working.
Machine is messed up.
They couldn't let anybody vote on the touchscreen machines because they had no working access cards, and everybody was voting provisionally.
And they told me the machines was down, and they couldn't get them up. Can I come back this afternoon? They said nothing about no paper ballots.
You're asking to leave because they're, why?
He said that they can't be
okay, thank you.
They're behind the flags.
I'll go over there.
There you go.
All right, you guys gonna bail me out?
Yeah.
We won't come to that, right?
Of course not.
All right.
You're a soldier of democracy, Dan.
All right,
here.
They said we could stand up there. Then we stood up there for like maybe about an hour, and they said, we know he come out, so we're gonna be arrested for criminal trespass. We don't get off the property and come across the street.
He said, come on, here,
I'm an attorney with election protection. I mean, I can tell you 100%, that's completely illegal.
So you interviewed someone who saw their vote flip for black one?
Yes. Yes.
Where's that tape?
We are short of machines.
Well, I've been waiting approximately 2 hours to vote, and I've just never seen it this bad in my life.
But the biggest shock of the day was yet to break.
Have you seen the headline on CNN and MSNBC?
What?
Breaking news.
What?
Because while you're doing this, Britney Spears is getting divorced. That is the breaking news.
That's the October surprise, you guys.
Right, exactly.
That's gonna like completely derail the election today. Carl Rove, he's a genius. Like
exactly.
I'm saying, man. You know, I had no idea they had this kind of poll.
But Kevin Federline wasn't the only loser of the night.
The Associated Press has now projected Ted Strickland as the governor-elect for the state of Ohio. Thank you.
Ken Blackwell was out of office, and that made me happy. The thing is about election protection, though, it's nonpartisan, and you're not really supposed to represent one side or the other. So, I just kept it to myself. Despite Blackwell's best efforts to suppress voters, you can only stop so many.
An enormous turnout, like the highest midterm turnout in decades. Raindrop from
your eyes. I've called Congressman Strickland and congratulated him and extended my best wishes.
Blackwell wasn't the only kingmaker kicked to the curb. Catherine Harris lost her bid for the U.S. Senate.
I say to you this evening, in the midst of a political setback, to God be the glory.
If Blackwell lost, then fair elections won.
It's all right to cry, little boy. I know some big boys that cry too.
Great news all across our great country. Change, friends, is coming to Ohio.
Better still for fair elections, Jennifer Bruner was elected the new Secretary of State. Once in office, she called for statewide election reform, ruling touchscreen voting machines unsafe. And with Diebold's voting machines being rejected in more and more states, they tried to sell off their election division. But after all the bad press, no one wanted it. So they changed the name to Premier Election Solutions. But then I read the news about a plane crash in Ohio.
Well, this sounds like a made-up story. One man rigging state elections to help his boss, President George Bush. After it's done, power players in Washington say, get rid of the guy.
45-year-old Michael Connell died Friday night after his plane crashed into this vacant house near Union Township in Stark County. Connell was a political power player in Washington, D.C., and in the White House.
He actually had to cancel two of his previous flights in the past few months alone because of some kind of problems or because there was some suspicion that there was something wrong with the plane. Mike Connell could have disclosed information that has been absolutely detrimental to the Bush administration, in particular, Karl Rove.
In 2004, in Ohio, Mike Connell built the Secretary of State J. Kenneth Blackwell's election night reporting system. He had been the one who had created the firewall in Congress for the Judiciary Committee. He had created the email system for the White House, the infamous email system for the White House, where millions and millions of emails had just disappeared somehow.
He was vehemently anti-abortion. I think that a lack of scruples required to manipulate votes and to set up secret email servers and things like that, somewhat mitigated by this ideological passion to save the babies.
Apparently, Connell was a real believer and really did believe in the Republican Party because he was a strict Catholic, and he thought that he was saving the children, saving the babies.
He was a true ideologue and not just a power junkie.
Stephen Spoonamore investigates bank fraud and computer fraud. He has looked at what happened in Ohio.
I do not believe George Bush won. I believe Kerry won, and I'm a member of the GOP.
It is his belief that what happened in Ohio was a man-in-the-middle attack, that the numbers that were reported on the website, frankly, have nothing to do with the actual way that people voted.
The kingpin, I thought, was probably sitting somewhere in the middle on the high-speed line. And the kingpin is a computer with a person sitting at it that doesn't just steal the information and then they use it later like we saw. It's a person who has on board their kingpin computer the code and instructions for the Secretary of State's office and the code and instructions for a county tabulator. Instead of this happening, this happens. So at 9 o'clock in the evening, Kerry's leading in Ohio. And the kingpin is watching these results go through, and this operator is sitting here at a company called Smart Tech Solutions. We now know.
This office had a backup system, election night reporting system with Smart Tech.
And remember, when I speculated this, everyone said, that's ridiculous, that's completely impossible. Well, we now found out that not only was I right, we know where it was sent. We didn't just have it introduced, it was designed into the Secretary of State's office that they could switch the control from their computer talking to the counties to have a smart tech do it. And then we found out who owned it, and then we also found out it's also doing Karl Rove's email. Like, that's brilliant.
And he has talked to Mike Connell, the guy who actually created this system that was used to report the results on election night in 2004 in Ohio.
I know Mike, and I like Mike. Mike and I share a lot of values.
He knew Connell personally and outed him, named him.
So he was subpoenaed for a deposition in this election fraud case. Once the subpoena became public, Mike Connell began to fight the subpoena.
We received an anonymous tip that Rove had threatened Mike Connell.
He was, in fact, sitting for his deposition on the Monday before the 2008 presidential election.
At times, Mike would look to his lawyer when he really didn't want to answer a question. He was looking at him to, you know, to raise an objection. I asked the question of what role he had in Smart Tech being part of the Secretary of State's computer system for election night in Ohio 2004. And his initial response was that, well, I don't recall that I did anything to influence that. And then I asked him the question, what subcontractors did you have under your contract with the Secretary of State's office? And at that point he said, I may have had Smart Tech as a subcontract under my contract.
During one of the breaks, I had the opportunity to talk to him. And I warned him not to fly his plane. His response was to, you know, kind of scoff and roll his eyes. And he mainly was kind of looking out the window. in the law office we were in looking at Cleveland. And I talked a little about his family, but mainly he talked about, you know, how busy he was and how, what a imposition it was to be brought in for a deposition.
Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. Vixen and Blixen and all his reindeers pulling on the reins. Bells are ringing, children singing, all is merry and bright. So hang your stockings and say your prayers, cause Santa Claus comes tonight.
In December, just prior to Christmas 2008, Mike Connell, who had been an accomplished private pilot, was on his way back from a meeting in D.C., back to Ohio, where he lived, for his company's annual Christmas party. Mike Connell never made it to that Christmas party.
We had a single engine, four occupant plane crashed here in this residence. We have a single occupant that has been deceased.
You can hear the engines cutting on and off, cutting out, and then you heard a big bang.
A lot of folks have shouted conspiracy theory that his plane was sabotaged, and in fact, in the weeks leading up to that crash, there were signs that he had been warned, that he had been threatened, perhaps by Karl Rove himself, that he, Mike Connell, should take the fall for what happened in 2004 in Ohio.
And there was a lot of question about the Karl Rove's relationship, both to him and to his untimely death.
There are quite a bit of oddities that have to do with his crash.
Protocol is that you rope off the crash site and post a watch, essentially, and you conduct the investigation during the daylight. And that wasn't done. They brought in lights, they removed the plane, everything was done in 2 hours. They were in and out, and the plane is gone. As much of the parts of Connell that they could find easily under the lights, those were taken away as well. But again, his wife came out the next day and found bits of him lying around. That's pretty unorthodox, I think, for federal crash investigations.
His sister believes that it was, in fact, murder. His wife now seems to believe something very strange went on. She was able to get his backpack back, which had everything in it except the BlackBerry, which she says he used to take everywhere. Was it murder? At this point, we don't know.
Stephen Spoonamore had said to me long before that deposition, Cliff, you realize the people we're dealing with, whack people.
In September 2009, investigators received an anonymous letter with a tip that Mike Connell's plane had been sabotaged, along with a redacted report detailing the operation in military shorthand. Mike Connell was described as NST, a national security threat. The return address did not exist, and the name on the letter was Mark Felt, the man known as Deep Throat, who had died a year before.
But sir, he asked about a company called Smart Tech.
I don't know anything about Smart Tech.
Well,
so that's...
My understanding is that Ohio actually had a contract with this company.
You know what? Let me tell you something.
Yes.
I, in fact, gave you my time.
Right.
I gave you my time in Ohio in 2004. We had a record turnout of African-American voters.
But that's not my question.
Excuse me,
sir, was about
my
the market.
Answer, my answer is this.
Right, but you're not answering my question.
No, my answer is this. Ohio, examined by Ohio newspapers and election authorities, had a good election, a clean election, not a perfect election, but a good and fair election in 2004.
But the question raises
that
smoke,
is
sir.
My answer.
Sir,
over now.
Can't really prevent them from trying to steal an election. But we can prepare people for that happening so that when and if it does happen, they won't simply keel over and feel defeated. like crawling home to die. That's what Kerry did to people when he conceded in 12 hours. People were so blindsided, traumatized, they just gave up for a couple of years.
So why can't I give this thing up? Elections are like a 4th of July parade. The community comes together once a year to watch the American process. You can see traditional politicians, as well as some dissenting opinions. It's open to the public, but not everyone makes it. You can be a spectator and cheer on the people you like. Or, if you feel strongly enough, you can jump in yourself. In Ohio, I met a lot of people who feel like me. We just can't stand on the sidelines anymore. And as Ohio goes, so goes the nation. If Diebold's motto is "We won't rest," then that should be our motto to reclaim our elections. We won't rest. So what is truth? I can't say I have all the answers. But if a lie repeated often enough makes it true, then the same should be true about truth. It's up to all of us to keep spreading it. The 4th of July used to be the most exciting day of the year for me, but now it's Election Day. That's the real Independence Day, when we celebrate how our democracy works. And we should all observe it, not just by voting, but by protecting our elections. If democracy isn't free for all, it isn't free for me. I may be just some dude, but these politicians in suits, the old guard running things, they're just some dudes too. I've always been shooting video, so I'm gonna do what I do to do my part. What's yours gonna be?
Yourself in a living room, your pipe and slippers set out for you. I know you think that it ain't too far, but I hear a call of a lifetime ring, felt the need to get up for it. Oh, and cut out the middleman, get free from the middleman. You got no time for the messenger, got no regard for the thing that you don't understand. You got no fear of the underdog, that's why you will not survive. I wanna forget how convention fits, can I get out from under it? Can I cut it out of me? Oh. It can't all be wedding cake, it can't all be boiled away. I try but I can't let go of it, can't let go of it. Cause you don't talk to the water boy, and there's so much you could learn, but you don't wanna know. You will not back up an inch ever, that's why you will not survive. Tell you now, it may not go over well. Oh, and it may not be thought too wild. No way that I spell it out. But you won't hear from the messenger. The
wanna know about something that you don't understand. You got no fear of the underdog. That's why you will not survive.